when I ask the question that which was the first helicopter, but more of when was the first helicopter flight, you probably think about this, but you already know that this is not the case, otherwise you wouldn't have clicked this video. During World War I, the army faced an urgent need for effective aerial observation. At the time, the primary method involved large hydrogen field observation balloons. These balloons, while providing a good viewpoint at what's going on the other side, they were fairly dangerous due to the highly flammable hydrogen gas. Also, they were an easy target for enemy forces due to their size. And also, they required a lot of time and personnel for setup and for operation. So the army needed something easier and faster to use. So they wanted to develop a new type of flying machine which is capable of vertical ascent. This ambitious vertical flight project was a result of a collaborative effort by three brilliant engineers from the Austro-Hungarian Empire. The initial concept originated in 1916 with Colonel István Petróci, a Hungarian aviator in the Austro-Hungarian Army. He proposed an electrically driven rotorcraft as a direct replacement for the dangerous observation balloons. Another important figure in the team was Theodor von Karman. He was another Hungarian engineer who later became famous as the father of the supersonic flights for his work in aeronautics and astronautics. Karman served as the director for the PKZ-1 project, contributing his knowledge of mathematics and aerodynamics to the design. The third key innovator was Wilhelm Zurovec, and I think this is how I pronounce his name, a Czech engineer whose contributions were vital to both prototypes. He independently led the development of the second machine, the PKZ-2, and was instrumental in its design and construction. The PKZ-1 was built in Budapest under Theodor von Karman's direction. It was something like 650 kg heavy. It was like a fairly long frame with four propellers and an observation gondola in the middle. The rotors were geared in pairs, spinning in opposite direction. This counter-rotation was critical for cancelling out the twisting force. All four rotors were driven by a single centrally located Austro-Daimler electric motor positioned beneath the observer's cockpit. To circumvent the challenge of heavy and underdeveloped battery technology at the time, the PKZ-1 was designed to receive its power from a ground-based electric generator and transmitted to the aircraft via a long cable. The motor was intended to produce 250 horsepower, but in practice it could only deliver around 190. Flight testing for the PKZ-1 commenced in March 1918 at Fishamend. During a brief series of four test flights, the machine successfully demonstrated its capability to lift three men. However, on the fourth flight, a critical failure happened. The motor's wiring insulation burned out. The wartime conditions meant that high-quality materials such as specific grades of copper and robust insulations were extremely scarce, and this made the repairs impossible. This unfortunate event effectively brought an end to the PKZ-1's development. Despite its short operational life and failure due to material limitations, the PKZ-1 holds a significant place in aviation history, as this was the first electric aircraft. Its design cleverly bypassed the issue of battery weight by utilizing a ground-based power source. Even though this, let's call it the helicopter, did get cancelled, it validated the fundamental concept of electric propulsion for vertical lift. Developed parallel with the PKZ-1, the PKZ-2 was largely an independent project led by Wilhelm Zurovec, though he acknowledged the support of Petróci. This machine was different from the PKZ-1 by using traditional internal combustion engine rather than electric power. The PKZ-2 had three radiating arms, each housing a rotary piston engine. Then these engines were coupled together to drive a central pair of large wooden coaxial counter-rotating propellers or rotors, each of them measuring 6 meters in diameter and mounted above the airframe. The aircraft apparently was quite heavy for its time, weighing over 1,200 kilograms without an observer, but I only found this in one source, though this weight might not be incorrect. Flight trials for the PKZ-2 commenced on 2nd of April 1918. Initially, it was equipped with 300 horsepower Gnome rotary engines, but these proved weak to safely lift the heavy aircraft. So they were replaced fairly quickly with more powerful 120 horsepower Lerone rotary engines. With these upgrades, the engines, the PKZ-2, demonstrated impressive performance for its era. Capable of rising to a height of over 50 meters and hovering up to a half an hour. Remember, we are only 15 years after the first controlled and sustained flight of an engine-powered aircraft built by the Wright brothers. Despite its ability to lift and hover, the PKZ-2 remained fairly unstable. To maintain control, it consistently required long tethering cables which had to remain under tension. To make matters worse, any faltering of the engines could cause the tethers to slacken, leading to loss of control. On 10th of June 1918, during a demonstration for high-ranking military officials, Zurovich was complaining about the Lerone engine's reliability. His concern proved justified when the engines faltered during the flight. The ground crew managing tethers panicked and resulting in a crash landing from approximately 2 meters. This severely damaged the aircraft and destroyed its rotors. Following this, the project was cancelled on 21st of June 1918 as the military leadership deemed it too dangerous for the observers to get on this and fly high or fly up. The challenges encountered by both the PKZ-1 and PKZ-2, such as insufficient power, engine unreliability, overheating, and instability, these were not unique failures of these specific designs. They represented problems and systematic limitations of early 20th century engineering that all early aviators had to face. Basically, both designs had similar issues: unreliable and weak engines compared to the weight of the machines. This indicates that the PKZ engineers were pushing the absolute boundaries of available engine technology and control systems of the time. The question of what constitutes the first helicopter is complex and depends heavily on the definition used. The concept of vertical flight has a long history dating back to Leonardo da Vinci's aerial screw design in the 1480s and early models powered by spring and steam. Even before the PKZ, other pioneers like Jacques and Louis Brackett in France achieved brief but unstable hops with the gyroplane number 1 in 1907. Also, Jacob Ellehammer in Denmark conducted successful vertical hovering tests with his rotary wing machine between 1911 and 1916. The PKZ designs occupy a unique position in this timeline. They were made as tethered observation platforms referred to as Schraubenfesselflieger, meaning propeller-driven captive aircraft. They were never intended to fly freely. Their stability and control was relying on these long cables. However, the PKZ-2 achieved rising over 50 meters and hovering up to half an hour. This made it one of the most advanced manned-powered vertical lift aircraft to fly during World War I. Actually, some historical accounts refer to the PKZ-2 as the first real helicopter and only helicopter which flew in the skies of World War I. To clarify the historical records, the first operational helicopter, meaning that could be used regularly for practical purposes, is generally considered the Focke-Wulf Fw-61, which made its first flight in 1936. The first practical helicopter that could fly freely, be reliably controlled, and eventually be mass-produced is widely recognized as Igor Sikorsky's VS-300. It made its first free flight in 1940 and laid the foundational principles for modern helicopter design, including the single main rotor and tail rotor configuration. The various claims to the first helicopter highlight that technological progress is an incremental journey rather than a single, yep, we made it now moment. Despite its relatively short operational life and eventual cancellation, the PKZ project represented an important step in the long and challenging journey of helicopter development. It successfully demonstrated the feasibility using multiple rotors for lift and the effectiveness of counter-rotating propeller system to manage torque in vertical flight. Furthermore, the PKZ-1's pioneering use of electric power, even if limited by the technology of its era, proved that the electric motor could serve as the main power source for heavier-than-air aircraft. This was a vision far ahead of its time. If you just think about that, electric airplanes are just being developed nowadays, and we already started to experiment with them 100 years ago. The ideas and lessons learned from PKZ project did not vanish with its cancellation. After the war, engineers such as Oskar von Aschbott continued to develop designs based on the PKZ-2, leading to subsequent successful tethered flights in the late 1920s. Moreover, the clever counter-rotating rotor scheme, which was central to the PKZ-2 design, was later adopted by the Soviet Kamov helicopters, proving its long-term influence on rotorcraft designs and demonstrating the enduring value of these early experiments. If you got this far, thank you for watching my video. Don't forget to like and subscribe and share the video, start a conversation about the topic in the comment section. And this is again one of those machines which been invented in the Austro-Hungarian or been developed in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, but then during the war, but then swiftly forgotten. So not the first one, not the last one. Which one was your favorite? This, the tank, or the hovercraft? Leave a comment and bye.